Last week was Father's Day, and we were talking about blueprints in life, and that we needed a strong foundation. But did you know that sometimes the foundations that we need in our life are to fight a battle? How many of you guys know that it's real out there? And did you know that the devil is not fighting fair? How many of you guys know that the devil does not fight fair? I was going to bring in my big sword today and have somebody stand up here and have a little kid come up and say, is this a fair fight? And give them a plastic sword. But regardless of what we're doing in our life, sometimes the things that we need the most for that foundation, continuing on with the blueprints of life, is to know how to fight the devil. How many of you guys know that to be true? And if we can't fight the devil, if we can't practice those values in our home, if we can't instill them to our children and our grandchildren and our nieces and nephews, we're losing the battle right from the start. Because it's important that we set that foundation. And in that foundation, we fight the battles. Today we're looking in Ephesians chapter 6. And we're going to be looking at verses 10 through about 22 or 23, somewhere around there. And today I'm reading out of the English Standard Version because I like how it's said it in the English Standard Version. It says, finally be strong in the Lord and his strength and might. Put on the whole armor that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Like I say, the devil is not fighting fair. But in Joshua 1:9 it says, have I not commanded you to be strong and courageous? Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And regardless of what we're facing, how many of you guys are facing a battle in your own life? Whether it's a struggle, whether, you know, the battles that we face in our life, we can turn to God and say, God, I need deliverance. But the first thing that we see right here, it says to do what? It said to run from everything that we're doing. Or did it say to stand firm in what we were doing? To stand. So sometimes in our battle, we're going to be faced with things that we do not want to run from. But by the same token, we don't have to advance on the problems, but we can stand firm where we're at, and we can meet head on with the devil, face to face, with God's help. How many of you guys know that we can do that? So when it says stand firm in the things that we're doing, first thing that we need is a strong prayer life. Second thing that we need in order to be able to stand is that we need to understand what the Word of God is saying to us in our life. How can I fight the devil if I don't have the right tools? The Bible, God's Word, tells me everything that I need to know to win the battle. And I read the end of the book, and in Revelation, it says that God wins. So just so you guys have a spoiler, God wins. If you want to take a look and read at the end of the book, it says God wins. And because we are on God's side, you and I have the capability of winning the battles that we face today. And as I said, the devil and his schemes do not fight fair. He does everything he can to try to trick you and I into being deceived, to make entreaties with him, so that the battle is already won. But I want you guys to know that we don't have to make a treaty with the devil. We don't have to be on his side. I want you to know that we are victorious because God is already in our lives. Can somebody say amen to that?
Amen.
You know, God is there with us. And it goes on and says, in verse 12, it says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over the present darkness and the spiritual forces of evil and in the heavenly places. Therefore, it says, take on the whole armor of God that you may be able to run. Is that what it says?
Stand.
It said what?
Stand.
Withstand. So that means that I am planted, and it says I am able to withstand everything that the devil is throwing at me. Whether it's in our finances, whether it's in our health, whether it's emotionally, spiritually, all those things, I want you to know that God has already dealt with it, and we've already won the battle. And the devil is not fighting fair. We're going to see that today. You know, when Joshua, they came into Jericho, they saw Jericho, they saw the walls, and what did they do? They went to God and they said, God, this is bigger than what we are able to do. See, Jericho represents the world around us. And so they came to the walls of Jericho and they said, God, we know that because of the world that is there, we need you on our side. And then after Jericho, what did they do? They went into the city of Ai. And what happened? When they went into Ai, for you guys that don't know, when they went into Ai, see, Ai represents the flesh. In Ai, they were defeated. It was smaller than Jericho. And Joshua said, I've got this whip. God, you go ahead and take a break, and we're going to deal with this all by ourselves. And the Israelites ended up running back. They ended up retreating because they failed to go to God and say, God, we need you in every area of our life. But see, it says that the things that we're fighting against, we cannot see. If I can see Jericho, it makes it easy for me to fight the battle. If I can see Ai in front of me, the flesh, it makes it easy for me to go to God and say, God, this is bigger than what I can do. What about the Gibeonites? You said, who? Yeah, those ones. Those, you guys remember the walls of Jericho. You remember the story. Go back and read Joshua. What did they do? They came in sneaking into the camp with moldy bread and torn clothes. And they said, Joshua, we heard how great you are and how powerful your army is. We've traveled for years trying to, we've traveled for months trying to make treaty with you. We now have moldy bread and they're only a day's out. And see, sometimes in our life, we make treaties with the devil. And Joshua made a treaty with the Gibeonites. And in doing that, he says, well, you know, how many of us say, well, you know, I just compromise a little bit with my Christian faith. It's not that big of a deal. If I just go in and if I just do this one little bitty thing, it's not going to have any effect on me. But whenever we give up the values of our Christian faith, we're compromising with the devil. I want you to know that. Because my Bible says, don't give the devil a foothold. In other words, keep everything that we have in line with what God's doing in our lives. And it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil day. And in what you do, stand firm. A police officer, what do they wear on their outside of their clothes? Paula, what does your husband wear? That vest?
A
bulletproof
vest.
A what?
A bulletproof vest.
A bulletproof vest. Uh-huh. For those that work in corrections, Natasha, what do the correction officers wear?
Bulletproof vest.
Ah, it's also staff-proof, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Because they're trying to protect everything that they have. Natasha, when she goes to work in the businesses, yeah, the prison system. She goes in with her armor. She's armed with a whistle. She's armed with her garage door opener, which is called a personal alarm device, a pad. And she goes in there with all the skills that she knows how to do. Am I correct?
Yes.
So in the event that something goes wrong, she's going to push her little panic button. And she's going to be safe because the army's coming. I want you guys to know today that we have an armor that we can go to battle with. And I want you to know that there's only two offensive weapons that God has given us. Number one is the sword. Number two is prayer. Everything else that God tells us here is on the defensive. We are taking a stand against the schemes the devil throws against us. What about a football player? What do they go into a football game with? When they're playing tackle, Don't they have all their padding on? Don't they have their helmets on? What about the catcher on the Dodgers? See, I got the Dodgers in there for you, Angie. What about the catcher? You know, if it was the San Francisco Giants, I would tell you it would be Buster Posey. But what do they have on when they go there behind that plate? Do they have an armor on? And when they go there, they're fully prepared for everything that's coming against them. And their job is also to protect the umpire. Am I correct? The umpire has that little padding and he has the little helmet that comes down, but they're standing there. Who takes the brunt of the punishment? It's the catcher. And every once in a while, he misses and the umpire gets knocked in the face. And they give him a minute to kind of recoup, you know, at 100 miles an hour. But the truth is that what you and I are facing is a bigger battle than anything that we will ever see. And we need the full armor of God. Because if I go to battle without everything that God has given me, and if I go into battle, when I was in the military, if I was in a battle position, my life expectancy was a whole 2 minutes on the flight deck of the carrier. Well, that's good because my whole life was increased by 100% from what my buddies were. Theirs was only a minute. But see, God has given us an arsenal to go and prepare for battle. And we are in a battle today. Everything that you and I are doing, the devil doesn't like it. And it says, having fastened the belt of truth. Oh, wait a minute. The belt of truth. You see, back in the biblical times, they didn't have nice, cool pants that we have. They had robes. And in the King James, it says, gird your loins. What that's telling you is get rid of the saggy pants and be ready to fight. Because what they would do is they would take and they would tuck it in, kind of making a pair of short pants so that they could move one way or another so that they didn't have the distractions. When I taught in the prison system, I kid you not, I had this one guy in my class and I said, I bet you, I know how come you got caught. He said, tell me. I said, because you were trying to outrun the quad. And I said, you had saggy pants on and you couldn't run faster than they could because your pants kept falling down. He said, well, that's true. How do you know? Because your pants are down now. Hold them up. But see, the truth is that God wants us to be prepared for battle. Pull up your pants and tighten the belt so your britches don't fall down when you're in battle. How many of you guys know that if you're in a battle and your britches fall down, you're probably going to lose the war? Last night, my buddy Mickey was talking about he had bought a new suit. He says, don't I look good? He said, I went over to Pastor Dave's house and I was changing clothes. And he said, my wife had asked me before I left, did you try any new clothes? No, they're good. They're good. And he's kind of got that same problem going on in his life. He has a bigger waist than the legs, you know, are designed for. So he said that he got over to my house, and on his new pair of trousers, you know, he goes to put them on, and, you know, there's a button in there, and he buttons the button, then it has a little clasp. That little clasp thing came off, so he says, I hope my britches don't fall down today. But see, the thing is, God says, pull up our pants, put the belt on, and get ready to move. Because the belt of truth right here, that's part of our armor. How can you fight a battle with saggy pants on? You're going to get caught. You're going to get caught in those kind of situations. And it says the breastplate of righteousness. Oh, wait a minute. Let's talk about that. The breastplate of righteousness. What is it doing? It's protecting my vital organs. Just as Mike, whenever he's out there, around the office, hopefully he's not having to wear a bulletproof vest. But whenever he's out on the field, he has that thing on because he doesn't want to get shot in the vital organs. And it says the breastplate of righteousness. Wait a minute, what is righteousness? That's our morality. That's all those things that come into being. And it says that God has given us that. Man, is our nation lacking in morals today? Let me ask this question. Is the church lacking in morality? The church itself is lacking in morality. When I'm talking the church, I'm talking the universal church. God's people, we're lacking in morality today. Because we've compromised, we've signed treaties with the devil, and we've allowed things to come in that should never have been. But see, we go on and it says, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and your shoes and your feet, having the readiness to preach the gospel. Wait a minute! I remember when I was a kid, I was 4 or 5 years old, and I had to put my dad's size 10 shoe. Well, actually, I think he had only had 9. My dad's shoes were a size 9, but when you're 4 or 5 and you try running in your daddy's shoes, how many of you guys know it's impossible to do? What happens? Lexi, when you were a little girl, did you ever put on your mom's shoes and run through the house and fall down? Because the shoes were too big for you. Especially if they had pumps on them. You know, if they had the heels or whatever. Man, don't laugh, but guys, when I was a kid, mom's shoes were there, and I had 3 brothers and 1 sister, and we thought it'd be funny to put mom's high heels on. For you ladies that can walk in high heels, bless you. I don't see how it was even a possible task, but what I'm saying is God has given us our shoes, and to be fit properly with shoes, isn't that an important thing? Randy, when you go hunting, are you wearing a pair of flip-flops? What are you wearing when you go hunting? Boots that are broken. You're not wearing a brand new pair. Because if you do, you're going to get blisters. And see, when I was in the Navy, we had what we called combat boots. They were steel-toed boots. And the only time that we had a, well, we had a run, and I hate running. And I hated running with those steel-toed combat boots on. Am I right, Jeff? But they've changed it. They don't have the steel-toed combat boots that we have. They now have really cool boots. I said, I like those. Why don't you get me a pair of those? Because they're cool. They lace up and they look really cool. And they fit better than those combat boots. They still might have steel toe in there, but when your feet get cold, there's warmers in there now. And so when we go to battle, God says, I want you to have the proper shoes on because you're going to take a stand. And when you take a stand, the devil's going to come against you with everything that you have. Now, flip-flops, Mike, I know you like wearing flip-flops, but are you going to wear flip-flops where there's a bunch of rattlesnakes out there?
Depends on how hot it is.
Depends on how hot it is. I'm going to have boots because I don't want the snakes biting me. And if they grab a hold of your boots, hopefully they're biting into leather. But God has given us the shoes, and he says, use your shoes. He says, wear the right size shoes. Man, when I was in junior high school, I was going through a pair of shoes a week. My parents couldn't afford to keep me in shoes, let alone clothes. Grew 6 inches in a matter of about, or 8 inches in a matter of 3 weeks, and I was exhausted. You know, I'd go to bed with a knot on my forehead, wake up and get on my cheek, you know, type of thing. But I went through shoes so fast. And my parents said, how can those shoes be too small? We just bought them last week. Don't you realize how expensive those shoes are? Well, Dad, they don't fit. What do you mean they don't fit? They fit last week when I bought them. Any of you guys ever been there? And you're going through the shoes, and what happens when your shoes are too small for you? Do they hurt your feet? When they are too big for you, what happens? You can't move properly. And God says, I want you to be prepared for battle. And everything that you do, he says, I'm giving you these tools. And then we come to the shield of faith. The shield of faith. We have our sword in one hand. For me, I'm going to hold the sword in my right hand because I'm right-handed, and that's my stronger hand. I'm going to hold the shield in my left hand so that I can fight. And I'm going to have the breastplate on because it's covering every vital part of my body. But this shield, I want you to know, it's 4 foot by 2.5 feet wide, according to history. Man, when I have a shield like that, can I stop the flaming darts that are coming against me? Yes, I can. See, that whole shield purpose was designed so that I can get down and I can protect my whole body with the shield of faith. Oh, wait a minute. Pastor, you're forgetting about one other thing. You're forgetting about the helmet. Oh, the helmet. Is that important for us when we're fighting a battle? You guys remember watching the TV shows with the knights? Not that any of us are old enough to remember that, but back in the days of the knights, they're in a full armor. And it looked really cool. You know, you couldn't sneak up on anybody because everywhere you went, you know, clank, 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 clank. But what did they have? They had that shield upon them, on their head, the helmet. And God says, it's so important when we're fighting against the devil because he's doing everything he can to come against you, that we have our mind protected. Because guess what? What gets into my mind, if I allow it in my mind, it comes into my heart and it becomes part of who I am and it destroys me from the inside. Our thought process. And it says, it's important that you have the right gear when you go to battle. The helmet of salvation. The impure thoughts that come by. Man, I'm not saying that they're not going to bombard us. But man, when those things come by, I don't have to say, oh, come on in. It's kind of like a bird whenever it flies over. If you guys have ever been to AT&T Park or Oakland Coliseum, the seagulls come out, they know when it's the ninth inning. And they start circling. And hopefully they're not dropping anything on you while they're circling. But that's why you wear a ball cap. But there's times that I've been there at those parks. And guess what? The seagulls had a better aim and I didn't have a hat on. All I'm saying is whenever those thoughts come in, I don't have to entertain them. And I don't have to allow those seagulls to make a mess in my hair. They're going to fly over. Those thoughts are going to come by. We can't stop the thoughts that are coming. But we do have the ability to say, I'm not going to entertain those thoughts. And that's where the helmet comes in. Because it protects us. Man. And we continue to read. And it says in verse 16, in all circumstances, take the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. We have to have the sword of the Spirit when we're fighting that battle. We have to have God's word with us. And it says, which the word of God. And here's the really cool thing. Praying at all times. Praying at all times. Now, if we're fighting a battle, what's back here in back of me? Am I protected in back? Chance, can I borrow you for a second?
Sure.
Come here. Okay. Now, if I go to battle, I don't know about you, I want him on my side. Okay, so now here's what happens. If we're fighting a battle, we're both fighting like this, we're both, our back is subject to do what? Be an attack, right? But if you go this way,
I knew I was going to stand in front of you.
And I go this way, what happens? And if I say, I got your back, what am I doing to him? Am I protecting his back from the flaming darts? Is he protecting my back? So that's where the terminology, I've got your back covered. Because now I can fight a battle and we can fight together because of what's going on. He has his sword, I have my sword, and we're beating the devil. Because I have his back, he has my back. And the cool thing about that is during this time period, when you got tired and you were going to go to sleep, because I had all that gear on, we would sit down back to back so that I had his back at all times. How many of you guys think that's pretty cool? Thank you, Chance. But like I said, I want somebody like that fighting the battle with me. How many of you guys want Chance fighting the battle with you? How many of you guys would rather have God fighting the battle with you than Chance? As much as I love Chance, you know, as good as you are, I'd rather have God on my side, covering my back. Because guess what? Humanity's going to let us all down. Am I correct in that? We're going to let each other down. But God says, take up the full armor of God. And he says, when I say I've got your back, he says, I want you to know that you don't have to worry about what's back here. Stand firm and be sincere in what you're doing, because if I'm watching your back, you can fight the battle. There's no sneak attacks coming from me, because God's got my back and I'm fighting the battle. He's also got the front of me. He's also got the sides of me. How many of you guys think that's pretty cool? That we can have a God that cares about us that much. But see, it comes with prayer. It comes with taking up the sword. It comes with reading God's word. How can I fight if I don't know God's word? Oh, wait a minute. I remember something. Oh, what was it? Maybe the only thing that we can remember is John 11:35. Jesus wept. Well, that's a start. What about John 3:16, when we remember that? And we're able to fight the devil. Wait a minute. You need to get away from me, because God says he loves me. And God has given me the full armor to come in and to fight. How many of you guys think that would be pretty cool? And then see, later on we can remember the 23rd Psalms. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. Oh, wait a minute. We could always go to the first book of the Bible, the first verse. In the beginning, God created. How many of you guys think it's important to memorize the Word of God? If we don't know what the Word of God says, how can I fight the devil? Years ago, I heard a story of this lady, and the only thing that she could remember, she was trying to think of the scripture in Isaiah that says, God covers us with his feathers. She was being attacked, true story. I heard it when I was in Fremont, California, when I was a kid, and I trust the people that told the story. So all she could remember, she was trying to quote, you know, God has me covered with his feathers. So she was under attack. Somebody was trying to mug her or whatever it was. And she started yelling, I'm covered in fleas! I'm covered in fleas! I'm covered in fleas! And they left. But if we don't know the word of God as our sword, how can I go to battle if I don't have my sword with me? If my prayer life's not where it's supposed to be? How can I have the helmet of salvation if I am allowing the or entertaining thoughts to come into my mind? But see, we have our armor so that I can protect myself. And if need be, I can scrunch down, and with that 4-foot by 2.5-foot shield, I can hide by there. Chance, yours is going to need to be a little bit bigger. You know, but
I feel like you.
But, you know, the truth is, regardless of that, God says, I want you to go to battle with the full armor. He says, I want you to be prepared. And he says, in everything that I'm telling you, he says, I'm not telling you to run out and face the battle all alone. He says, take a stand, because they're going to come against you. The devil's going to come against you and I and our life. And he says, take a stand and plant your feet solid, and get somebody to cover your backside when you're fighting that battle. Because the devil's going to come against us at every angle he can. But we need to know how to fight the battle. We're going to close in prayer. Maybe some of you guys are going through a real battle in your life. Struggles. God says, I want you to know that the battle's already been won. But you have to go in with full armor of God. It's never too late to come to the altars or anything else. If there's things that are going on in your life, these altars, I want you to know, are always open. We're going to close in prayer. Maybe you just want to spend some time in the Lord. Father, I thank you, Lord, for who you are. Lord, I thank you that you are my shield. Lord, you are my helmet. You are my sword. Lord, you've given me the feet. But God, you've given me the proper shoes to fight the battle. Lord, you've allowed me to pull up my britches so that they don't fall down. God, I thank you for all those things. But Lord, I thank you that you have my back. Lord, you have my front and my sides. And regardless of what I'm going through in my life, I don't have to face the battles alone. Lord, I ask that you just watch over us. Father, we ask that you just bless the community worship today. Lord, we ask that you just continue to love us and help us to fight the battles that we need, because we can't do it on our own. In Jesus' name, amen.